to change it up so we're not like starting based on where folks are in their careers. So I wanted to ask you how science has influenced or driven your activism. And then also, and I realize in this panel this might be a loaded question, but did you see yourself becoming a professional scientist at some point?
So to answer the first part of the question, how does science influence my activism? It influences my activism quite a bit because obviously I'm a climate activist, so I have to use science with my activism. And for example, when I'm lobbying a representative or when I'm telling someone, this is what law we need to make, it needs to have science in it so it actually helps, you know, solve the climate crisis, so it actually helps lower carbon levels. So I use science really to kind of base what I lobby for, what I advocate for. The youth versus government lawsuits, have you all heard of the youth versus government lawsuits, by the way? Okay, so I'll say this. So pretty much as young people, we have the constitutional rights to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, right? Just Americans, that's what we have, those rights. And so what the youth versus government lawsuits are arguing is that without clean air, clean water, a livable future, a clean planet, a livable planet, we can't pursue happiness. We can't fulfill that without a livable earth. So that is what the Youth v. Gov lawsuits are. And so pretty much young people, the organization Our Children's Trust is helping young people sue certain levels of government. So there's a lawsuit where they're suing the federal government, the entire United States. Some of my friends are on that one. I am not. And then there is a different lawsuit that is helping us sue the Washington State government. And so I'm on that. And the way science plays into that is that pretty much what we're saying is we're suing for a climate recovery plan. We're suing to ask them, our generation is screwed right now because of climate change, and we need to get down to a certain level of carbon in the atmosphere by the end of the century. 350 parts per million is what that number is, before it's too late. And so that's what we're suing for. We're suing the governments to implement a law that says we must do whatever it takes to get there, both federally and in the state of Washington. And that's how science plays into what I do. It plays into pretty much everything because, you know, science is how we discovered how climate change existed. And then the question of if I want to be a scientist, I actually want to run for office, but not usually exclusive, but I'm kind of bad at STEM.
Okay. So I then, for our panelists, have some questions there.
Well, I have several identities. At the moment, right now, I'm young. It's not going to stay like that forever. I am mixed race, so on my dad's side, my parents are both here. On my dad's side, white, Ashkenazi Jewish, and on my mom's side, I'm Colombian, so I'm mixed Latina. I speak fluent Spanish, and then also I'm a girl. And so I think the young girl part plays a really big role in my activism, because in my activism, I do a lot of talking to politicians and speaking and confronting people. And when you're young, people don't take you seriously, but when you add girl to that, it's like disaster. So there's a story. I was in Olympia one time lobbying for a carbon tax bill, and that you can see when you sit in the place where you testify on behalf of a bill in the hearing room, you can see like people sit down before they testify, and then you go up in front of the panel and you say why the bill should or shouldn't pass. So I was there, and you can see, you know, the activists like me and my other youth activist friends who were there to like speak on behalf of it. And then there are, you can tell who the petroleum lobbyists and all the lobbyists are, because they're usually a bunch of old white men in suits, and sorry, a few women, I'm not gonna say that, but so you can tell, and they have suits, and then they have like a little pin that's like says their lobbying company. And so after speaking, when we were in the place and they were testifying, they were saying a bunch of lies, they were trying to twist the science. They were like, no, climate change isn't that big of a deal. Oh no, passing this bill will hurt our company, boo-hoo us. And then I got out of the thing and I was confronting, I actually have this picture somewhere in my phone of me just glaring at this lobbyist, because I'd confronted him and I'm like, actually that's not true of what he said, and I tried to tell him, and then he like called me sweetie on multiple occasions, and he was like, it was very mansplaining, and it was very, no, you don't, oh, we're talking about big corporations really care about you and doing the best for you, mm-hmm. and don't waste your time like testifying here and lobbying, you know, you should be doing other things. So the sexism and youthness kind of gives people like that. I'm sure if I were like an older man, he wouldn't like call me sweetie or do things like that, but be, or you know, tell me that I have no place there or that I don't belong or that I don't know what I'm talking about. If I were an older man, he would see me as an equal. But because I'm a young woman, not even woman, I'm 16, because I'm a young girl, he's like feels the power to just look down on me. So that's how my identity is playing with my activism.
Not in
college,
but also obviously, but I do go to a very competitive school. That's a private school and also a Catholic school, even though I'm not Catholic. I'm the Jewish girl in Catholic school. But anyway, so I guess some tips I have for dealing with, I mean, I have the experience of right now in the classes that I don't succeed in, which are, in this panel, it's kind of sad, but I'm a very humanities-based person, very politics-based person, so the classes that I'm having trouble with are math and science. Great panel to be on. But anyway, I've gone up to my teachers many times and I've been like, hey, I really don't get this. And so my math teacher's like, oh, okay, I'll help. But it's like very, he's just like does it and he's like, okay, great. He's just not a very good teacher. And then I go up to my science teacher and he's just like, figure it out. And I'm like, thanks. So the way I kind of cope with that is, well, first of all, mentally you have to realize like, if like you're not getting as high of scores as you want, like you have to acknowledge that if you're working hard enough during that class, then part of it is not on you. Like you can't just blame it all on a bad teacher, but if you're trying your very best, mm-hmm. but your teacher is just not helping you, then you kind of have to mentally just get in that state of like, okay, I kind of have to accept that I'm not gonna ace this class. And then I usually, in high school, you know, we have a very close-knit community forced to be in one building. So I usually go up to my friends. We'll be calling each other late at night. I think like finding some people in your class is really helpful. And then also the internet is a thing. and that is, I just survived final exams last week. And using YouTube videos and everything is pretty much how I get through my classes with bad teachers. Everything was great and on track, and then Trump came in and ruined everything, and all we have to do is get back to where we were before Trump. That is not true. Like, the UFNIGOV lawsuit started out suing the Obama administration because it was way too weak, and with things with climate change, if people think, oh, well, that's better than nothing, but it's kind of a, or we're all saved or we're all screwed, but there's no, like, middle ground with that. As for, like, organizations that have been, I don't think that we can get anything done on the federal level right now. I'm definitely going to be, I'm going to D.C. next weekend to do some federally related stuff. But I think most of the successes that we're going to get, at least while Trump is in power and while we have our wonderful government, is to focus on, like, city councils and state legislatures and kind of doing things like educating the legislators about like science and doing things about like just talking to them, maybe bringing lobby groups. You would be surprised at how very, very ignorant a lot of the representatives are about these scientific issues. I'm going in with like little kids, not little kids, but like 11, 12, 13, like oldest maybe 17, going in and lobbying about climate change, and we're like, yeah, so we need to get down to 350 to solve this issue and blah, 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 blah. And then they're just like blank face, like they just barely know. They're like, okay, climate change bad, emissions, lower them, we don't know by how much. And so I think some organizations that are doing some good lobbying things like that are the Alliance of Jobs and Clean Energy. They do some good work. Plant for the Planet, which is a group that I'm a part of, but that's more youth-centered. And just 350.org, they've been doing a lot of lobbying expeditions here. So I would say focus on the state and city and local. And then there has to be like a big influence on educating representatives and making sure that the people that you're elected are educated. There was a panel that the youth from Plant for the Planet organized for mayoral candidates here, mm-hmm. where we would ask them about climate change. And a lot of them, some of them were pretty knowledgeable, but you can tell some of them just had very, very basic knowledge about things. So educating
politicians, doesn't seem like something you'd have to do, but it really is.
What about our current mayor? What'd she say?
Jenny Durkin was, I wasn't their president, I helped organize it, but I heard that she was kind of like the Jay Inslee kind, where she's very like centrist in the climate community. I didn't really want her to win as much as Carrie Moon, because Carrie Moon was way stronger on climate and science, but she was just kind of the general, like, kind of centrist, like, Democrat, where it's like, yes, we should solve this, but it's like, how? And that's not saying that I have no faith in her and stuff. I mean, I think she's pretty cool, but I think it's kind of our job to educate people like Jenny Durkin and stuff, and even Jay Inslee. Jay Inslee, everyone says he's a climate guy, but we had to sue him to get him to pass this clean air rule that he's been bragging about it, and he's been bragging about this clean air rule while the kids who sued him for it are in the same room. And let me tell you, it is the crappiest clean air rule to ever exist. It lowers emissions by 1% on a few corporations, and for like minimal, we need like 10% on all corporations. So even people who you think are like Democrats, or oh, they're leftists, so they're good, and no worries, let's just focus on Republicans. You should focus more of your energy on at least like people who are more liberal leaning, or more centrist or more democratic. At least they'll listen to you, and really just focusing on like getting them to know what they need to know. Yeah, I rambled on that.
I'd also say, like, if I just wanted to summarize it, other things that need to happen are increasing scientific literacy, fighting for scientific funding, and the reduction of scientist muzzling, which is not today.
Hi, my name's Jamie. I'm a sophomore in high school, and I'm one of the plaintiffs on the Youth versus Government lawsuits, on the Youth versus Government lawsuit in Washington State, and I'm a community organizer with the organization Plant for the Planet, and the executive director of Zero Hour, which is a youth-led mass action organization for youth on climate. I guess one last thing that I'd like to leave you all with is that the antidote to hopelessness is action. So, you know, with the climate crisis, it's very easy to get hopeless, and it does look it does look pretty grim, and we shouldn't sugarcoat it, but then you get into the trap where you're just like, well, it's so bad, I guess I'm just gonna throw my hands up and enjoy the ride down. But we should avoid that, and I think one of the ways, for the adults in the room, it's really important to be supporting, you know, youth who are taking action on this very important issue, and support us by helping us elevate our voices, mentoring the youth in your lives who you know who want to take action on this. And for all the young people in the room, you know, you don't have to be some sort of, none of us started as like some crazy activist. Like now at my school, because pretty much I started activism pretty much right after the election. Well, I was an intern on Hillary's campaign, but right after the election is when I started being an activist, and that's when I entered my freshman year of high school. So for all my high school friends, it's like, Jamie, yep, the activist, always posting about, like, on Instagram, like, oh, attended this event today, this rally, this blah, blah, blah. And so they just kind of throw it off as, that's not me, that's her thing. But it's also important to know that, like, I wasn't always like this. I was a gymnast, pretty content in my own, you know, world, like not really caring about what happened around me, but I just attended like one meeting, one community organizing meeting, and then little by little, it all kind of built up. So you don't have to be overwhelmed, and like, you don't have to jump in and be like a full-time community organizer immediately. You can just like attend an event and do this, make a call, and then it can build up. So that's kind of the words I want to leave.